around us is changing. Amid this change, we are here for you, helping you find, design, manage and invest in amazing spaces. We are JLL, the Real Estate Experts.
A very warm welcome to the guest of the honor and audience to the first section of guest lecture series presented by Kshitij, IIT Kharagpur. I, Harshit Shukla, welcomes the esteemed guest Dr. Ajay Kumar, the Defence Secretary of India. Dr. Ajay Kumar is an IAS officer of the Kerala cadre. Dr. Ajay Kumar is a B.Tech graduate in Electrical Engineering from IIT Kanpur. He also has a doctorate from Carlson School of Management, University of Minnesota, USA. Prior to being the Defence Secretary of India, Sir has held various positions in the state as well as the central government. During his career in the civil service, Sir has led myriad initiatives and contributions in the area of technology. On behalf of the entire Kshitij IIT Kharagpur family, I heartily welcome you, Sir. I would like to invite you to deliver the lecture.
Good evening. I hope I'm audible.
Yes, sir.
Good evening, friends. Good evening, Ajay. It's a pleasure to join all of you and to share some thoughts this evening with some of the brightest youngsters that we can find in the country. One of the motivation which I had when I thought of, agreeing to join you for this lecture was that in defense, we have embarked on a new journey of Atmanirbharta. And in this new journey, it has been my experience that our startups, our youngsters, bright minds with new approaches and not restrained by traditional constraints and limitations can do wonders. But before I talk about that, let me give you the overall perspective. When I was your age, I did not have this perspective, and therefore to share with you how important the defense sector is something which underlines and underpins why it is so important for us to develop this sector. Let me start by saying that the defense spending annually is between $2 to $3 trillion, and the arms trade is between $300 to $500-$600 billion. However, this business, global defense business, is controlled by a handful of countries. It is actually very ironic that the five permanent members of the UN Security Council are today responsible for nearly 3/4 of the global arms trade. But if we look at our own situation, we actually have a minuscule proportion of this trade. In fact, in terms of export, we were always number one importer in the world. It is only in the recent years that we have for the first time appeared in the top 25 exporters also. For a country of India's size and capability, a country which is today on the leading tangent of technology, it is really surprising that we have not been able to make a bigger mark on defense arms trade. And this is despite the fact that we have today the world's fourth largest defense budget. There is, you know, if we look at China, the example of China is right before us for a country which till a couple of decades back were largely dependent on imports for their arms and weapons, but today is become the third largest exporter of arms and weapons and is partaking in a big way in the global arms business. I mentioned to you that you have $400-500 billion of arms trade business that is happening globally every year, which is a big chunk. But actually, development of countries' own arms industry is not merely an economic goal. It is even more important from a strategic perspective. As an economic superpower, which we hope to achieve to become a $5 trillion economy, it is extremely important to ensure that we are able to protect the wealth we create as an economic superpower. And in the global tug of war, defense and economics go hand in hand. It is not uncommon to see global powers using various arm twisting techniques to achieve economic gains. And if you are dependent on other countries for your own defense, then to that extent, you are at some level also having to accommodate the... Ajay, am I connected or am I disconnected?
Yes, sir. So you are.
I am connected still because
yes, sir.
My screen has gone blank.
Sir, you're connected, sir.
Yeah, okay, good.
And carry on, sir.
Yeah, so at some level, if we are not able to have the strategic independence in terms of our arms, we will not be able to have economic independence either. So, what is that we wish to do? The fact of the matter is, since in this realization which I've just shared with you is not new, and we have continuously, since independence, aimed to achieve self-reliance in defense. However, it is also true that despite such aims, we have not had great success. We have created major public sector undertakings. Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, Bharat Electronics Limited, Mazagon Docks, Garden, Reach Shipping and Engineers in Kolkata, and others. But most of them, for most of their products, have continued to do licensed production. That is, the technology has remained that of a foreign country or a foreign company. And if the technology is theirs, there are two major disadvantages that we face. One is they put restrictions on the number, the quantity of equipment that you can manufacture here. They put restrictions on whether you can actually, where to use and how to use and where to sell and how to sell. And second is, when technology is licensed, invariably a hefty technology fee is charged, which I would like to call it as a premium on Make in India. So what used to happen, and for engineering students, it's very like you, it's important to appreciate this fact that what was happening is, while we were making the products in India, the defense products made in India were 20 to 30% costlier than those same products if they were imported to India. Now, In all the other sectors, we have all seen that make in India is typically cheaper than rest of the world. But here we are in defense, where make in India meant that if you were to get a product for 100 rupees and you decided to make in India, the cost of the product went up to 130. And this was also creating a problem. So therefore, the realization that came up was that we need to now change this. However, the question was, look, in last 75 years, we have not been able to make a big dent. We have continued to be an importer. Defense has been the frontier of technology. Even if you look at internet, which is today considered the building block for so many new technologies that have happened in the last 2.5 decades, came out of defense project, as you know. Most frontier technologies had come out in the past through defense. So the doubt that arose always in the minds of people is, when we are talking of defense technologies, we are talking of frontier edge technologies, and does India have the capability to do it? And the question is, the answer is, to my mind, clearly a big yes. Look at China. Like I mentioned earlier, 20 years back, China was a major importer. They have been able to do it in less than 20 years, convert themselves from importer to one of the world's largest exporters. You may be surprised to know, Mexico has one of the biggest aero components cluster with exports of over $10 to $15 billion. None of the major aircraft manufacturers that you know of are based out of Mexico. But in Mexico, you have the world's largest aero components manufacturing. If a country like, and they have done it in the last 2 decades, if a country like Mexico can do it, why can we not do it? Look at our own experience. When I was your age and when I was at IIT, one of the aspirations for all of us was to buy a Vespa scooter. I don't even know if some of you have heard the name of Vespa anymore. Vespa was a leading scooter manufacturer of Italy. And it was quite a big deal to be able to get a Vespa scooter. There was a booking, it used to take 5 to 7 years to get one. Bajaj had entered into a TOT with Vespa and had started making the scooters under the brand name of Bajaj. Look at now. Bajaj has long ended its TOT partnership, transfer of technology partnership with Vespa. And Bajaj is today world's biggest two-wheeler scooter manufacturer, with much more advanced technology than even Vespa was making. So we have crossed the hump of technology gap, which, if you look at Hero Honda, which some of you may be riding, similar story. Today, Hero doesn't have any collaboration with Honda. It is a brand on itself making bikes which are both used in India and abroad. We are today, you know, I have worked a lot in the IT sector, which has been my first call in terms of professional experience. We are the world's largest IT outsourcing destination in the world, with over nearly $200 billion of outsourcing. Yesterday we saw Pawan Agarwal become CEO of Twitter, and yet one more CEO from India. And of course, all IITians can be proud of that fact. When 10 years back, 15 years back, 20 years back, when IT, the thought of top IT company being an Indian company was never even considered. Accenture, IBM and all were way ahead. Today, TCS is the world's most valued IT company from India. But to me, the most important sign of the fact that we can do it has been the last 2 years. Look at where we were when COVID started. And I was part to some of the early meetings in January and February of 2020. And those days we used to see on our TV screens what was happening in Italy and Spain and US in terms of shortage of ventilators, in terms of shortage of testing and diagnostic facilities. And in India, at that time, we had nothing, practically nothing. We had no ventilator manufacturers. We made efforts to contact some of the global suppliers of ventilators to see if they could give us, and you know, given our scale and size, and all of them said no, because they all had huge commitments from their own countries. In the last 2 years, we have seen all equipment, all testing, diagnostics, PP kits, drugs, vaccines, all developed in India and produced to scale at a cost, a fraction of the cost of what it is in the rest other parts of the world. In India, the vaccine is being sold at by the producer at 300 rupees per vaccine. I was in US last month. The RT-PCR today here is done at a rate of about anything between 500 to 800 rupees RT-PCR test. A vaccination in US costs $300, roughly about 2,500 rupees. Look at the scale at which I can relate to you. The experience of Aadhaar, which I was instrumental in working when I was in IT ministry. Our Aadhaar system at that time enabled real-time ID authentication of an individual, and we were, now there is a nominal charge. At that time it was free. The total cost involved in setting up one Aadhaar ID was roughly 40 rupees, which was given to the CSE operators who were creating the ID of our Aadhaar. In most of the developed world, even today, a real-time ID authentication cost $1, which in today's terms is 75 rupees. Those days it was about 45 rupees. So I used to say, we have created Aadhaar infrastructure which at a cost of $1, and authentication is free. Whereas the world's IT infrastructure charges $1 every time a real ID is used. Today, of course, the world recognizes the power of Aadhaar, the power of UPI Bheem at such fraction of the cost. The point I'm wanting to make is, if we could do it in all these other sectors, why can't we not do it? But what are the important things that we see? What are the important changes that we need to make? One important lesson, if you see from the examples I quoted, is that many of these have been led by private sector and startups. Whereas in defense, we had somehow, in terms of sensitivity and security, we had exclusively depended on public sector. Now, public sector had done its great job, but monopolies have inherent inefficiencies, which most economic students will say with their eyes closed. So the first lesson that came is that we needed to get more participation from the private sector, and that government has done under all its very various policy initiatives. Today, the defense sector has been open to the private sector. The second important lesson which came was, and this is again for students like you, is not new or not surprising, but somehow in defense sector it had remained that it was a highly regulated department. The so-called ease of doing business that we see in some of the other sectors like IT and now electronics had not actually been enabled in the defense sector. And therefore, we decided we need to deregulate. One of the areas which has created, which we have recently deregulated and which has created tremendous amount of excitement among all youngsters, has been the recent drone policy. Some of you who are working in the area of drone, earlier it was not possible to, you know, if you were working in a drone, you could not fly the drones. And the permission process was so cumbersome, actually most people would never get it. Just to relate a story, one of the new startups who's now doing extremely well, and I will talk about that later on, but when I asked him, and so he was developing drones for armed forces, and when I asked him, where are you testing these drones? So he said, nahi nahi sir, hum to apne chhat ke upar uda dete hain. So I said, how do you do that? He says, humne local police wale se setting kar rakhi hai. The problem was the legal process of being able to fly a drone was so cumbersome that people were doing all kind of ad hoc arrangements, and this is not a healthy sign. So this is one major reform that was, for example, which has helped to deregulate processes. Similarly, again, I am not sure if those of you who are working in spatial domain, there was to get permission to create maps in India was next to impossible. We are all used to taking, and the permission required was from Ministry of Defense, which was for, and these are all age-old processes which were there, because at that time, feeling was if someone got map of your country or region, they could thereby, you know, be able to have access in ways which would be detrimental to the country. Today, we all use Google Map all the time, and you can zoom in to see every small building, let alone, you know, area. But we were not allowing anyone to do it. Anyone who is today satellites, people are taking is pictures at square feet level, and you are saying, no, you can't create maps within the country. And therefore, we were denying ourselves for people who are working in spatial related domains, location, navigation services, location based services. They were not able to do those services here in India. But the new map policy, which has been brought out this year, for example, has tried to deregulate these things and several others. I don't want to talk about everything. Third is the willingness to accept that what is produced in India is good. You know, in many of the sectors, this mindset has changed. But traditionally, we have suffered from mindset that if it is made in India, it cannot be good quality. Now, I don't know if my generation saw that. So if you could get a Japanese pen, it was good. If you could get an American, it was even better. You know, that kind of mindset. Things have changed a lot. Today, you know, youngsters are not, you know, when earlier generation, when I was your age, when a relative used to go abroad, when he came back, his bag would be full of goods that he would have bought, and he would distribute it in his family and friends and relatives, and people would be eagerly waiting for his return because of that. Not anymore. But in defense, we have found that there has always been this feeling that buy from outside, even if the same thing is being made in the country. And that's basically because you have feeling made in India is not as good as, and that is not all correct. So therefore, for the first time, what government has said is, they have said, let us identify items which are being made in India or can be made in India, and these items will not be bought from outside. Also, a list of 208 such items has been identified and notified last year, in the last 12 months. And today these items cannot be imported. And our effort is now, so what is this list of items? It doesn't, what the statement is, the message that is, that look, we trust our industry. We trust our innovators. We don't have to go out and buy these products from outside anymore. And I think that's something which is very important. Let me talk about the startup ecosystem. I don't have to tell, all of you are today potential, potential unicorns. But somehow, the defense ecosystem, defense is such a closed sector. There was, even the industry was not allowed to come in, big industries were not allowed to come in, let alone startups of youngsters who don't have the wherewithal to be able to deal with very huge defense framework. So we decided to change that. And there was a lot of question marks. Startups are small, they don't have the capital, defense projects are big in size, technologies are frontier technology, cutting edge technology. Can startups do it? Even let them try in other sectors, but startups in defense, unlikely. But in 2018, we started a program called IDEX, Innovation in Defense for Excellence. And if I tell you the journey of IDEX and startups has been one of the most remarkable journeys ever. We initially started with some 17-18 challenges which we threw. These were the same problems which armed forces had been facing and were either importing or were asking the public sector to give them solutions to those problems. In 12 to 18 months, startups came up with solutions. Something which would take 8 to 10 years was now, startups were coming up in 10 to 12 months. But more importantly, what used to cost hundreds of crores was now being getting done. The total development cost was 10 crores or 15 crores of that kind. So there was a fraction of the cost and fraction of time in which products started happening. For example, one startup in who was working in IIT Delhi, the challenge thrown was that you create a 1 megapixel camera. We are importing this camera. Cost of import is about 2 to 3 crores for each camera. They have not, in 12 months, the 100 megapixel camera was produced. The total cost of development was about 7 to 8 crores. Individual camera cost came down to 1/10. And the startup said, forget 100 megapixel, we will give you 1 gigapixel camera in some 12 or 18 months. 1 gigapixel camera is not even available. This typically we used to buy this from Israel. That camera was not even available with Israel at that time. And look at the cost by which it came down. And they said, we need only some 20-25 crores to develop that 1 gigapixel camera. Another startup came up with a solution which solved, so, you know, on ships or any ships, particularly naval ships, there is a huge problem of fresh drinking water. And so we import a very costly desalination plant which is installed on naval ships so that they can take seawater and desalinate it, which can be used by the crew on the ship because ships are away for months together. It's very costly, both in terms of the capital cost as well as the operation cost of that plant. And then if you have to go for repair and all, again, you have to depend on some foreign vendors. IIT Madras, one startup came up with a solution which uses some biochemical process. I am not fully conversant, but they showed that there's another problem in ship. The engine discharges oil sludge, which is part of the normal process of engines. And as per the global convention, you can't discharge that oil sludge into the sea because it will affect the marine life. So all naval ships have to carry big tankers to store this oil sludge. And when they come ashore, they discharge it onto land in a safe manner. So naval ships have to carry big tankers for storing the oil sludge. They have to carry a desalination plant to convert seawater into potable water. This startup came up with a biochemical process by which it uses engine sludge and seawater to produce drinking water. A huge innovation. And then I did some quick Google search and found this kind of work had just been started doing in US. Nowhere else in the world they were doing it. And this startup showed the lab prototype in about 12 to 18 months. And then now they're making a huge 10-ton plant, which is good for a big naval ship to be put up on the ships itself. And so on and so forth. Today we have nearly 1,000 startups who are working. Now compare this with, you know, typically earlier we were working on 10, 15, 20, 30 major problems. Today I have 1,000 startups who are working in different manners, with different ideas, different creative thoughts across the country on at least 200 different problems. So both the scale of problems and the way they use technology are all changing immediately. Today, so many of people are working in artificial intelligence, unmanned aerial. I spoke about this startup in who is now developed drone from scratch. And the Prime Minister on 19th of November this year handed over a drone which was designed, developed, manufactured 100% in India for the Indian Army in a function in Jhansi to the Chief of Army Staff. Now, the point I'm making is today you have people, youngsters, and at a fraction of a cost, who are doing these kind of things. And there are a teen number of stories. So today no one is saying whether startups can do it. Everyone is today absolutely convinced that this is possible, this is happening, and it's happening on a large scale. And so the power of startups. We are today waiting for the first. You know, I am personally aware of defense startups today getting a lot of investment inquiries, takeover inquiries. And I am just waiting now. We've seen a lot of unicorns in the commercial side. First defense startup unicorn happening in India. No big private industry could reach the scale of $1 billion in its net worth from defense business. But startups have shown that they can do it, and this can be done without. And look at it from perspective. I told you we were the biggest importer of technology. There is a company, which a startup, which is doing swarm technology. We discovered it when US Air Force Research Lab, which is their apex lab for Air Force research, approached us and said they want to collaborate with this startup on swarms, because none of the companies or startups or organizations in US has the same capability which this startup has been able to develop. A couple of other startups. Today Airbus is using for their supply chain solution developed by a startup in Bangalore. There are some other places also where Indian startups are being sought after by global OEMs. So from becoming, from being an importer of technology, importer of defense, we are today moving into a world where the world is coming to us seeking technology. And to me, we are on the tip of the iceberg. The full opportunities are yet to unfold. I don't want to, take more time. But let me conclude by saying that, you know, in the life cycle of every sector, there is a watershed moment. In IT, that watershed moment came in the early 90s. In electronics, I would say the watershed moment came around the middle of last decade, 2013, 2014, 2015. The decade of 2020 decade or the coming decade is that for defense sector. A number of changes that are happening, the positive energy that exists today in the industry, in the startups, in the armed forces, and the confidence that has come that we can do it. We did it when it was when it COVID came. We today are saying, and I am not going through all the various initiatives where government is taking to drive the industrial ecosystem in defense, but this is the moment. The moment has arrived. The opportunity has arrived. And I think for youngsters like you, who are not constrained by imagination, who are not constrained by what has happened in the past, the limitations of what could not be done in the past, I think the opportunities are there to be grabbed. Thank you very much, and I'm happy to take questions if any.
Thanks a lot for a lecture, sir. Sir, I truly believe your insights have provided us unique perspectives. So, sir, now we'll be starting our Q&A sessions. We had taken a few questions before, and the participants who have more questions can put their questions in chat box. We'll take from there also. So, sir, moving on with that. So, sir, first question, which was, which is that how is defense policy incorporated and integrated academica for defense technology?
So, you know, that's a very good question. And I think there is room for much greater integration of academia in defense. One of the ways by which today academia is getting integrated is through this startup mechanism, because the number of startups that we have seen are actually emerging out of the academic institutions. But on a more formal level, where I think there is more that needs to be done, is that the academic institutions have to become centers of excellence in specialized areas which are there. For example, engines, you know, engine power in defense is far more advanced than that is used in the civil and the commercial world. Aero engines, for example, which is used in fighter jets. And this is a highly complex, specialized subject, and where, you know, we will 100% need academic institution to house that expertise, and not only house it, create a critical mass of scholars around that area to be able to do adequately in an area like. So I think another related area is defense specific programs. We have not seen adequate focus on defense specific programs in universities. Some places, for example, IIT Kanpur has a department of aeronautics, but not too many places. Only one or two IITs have aeronautics also. There are not too many places where such kind of, you know, defense areas somehow have not got the requisite focus in our academic institutions. That is changing now. From the Ministry of Defense, we are today working. There is a broad policy decisions to work more with the academic institutions. That has started to happen. But I must say that this is an area where we must do more as a government.
Sure, sir. So, sir, next question is methods by which we can increase startups in the particular defense sector.
Yeah, so I think on the startup side, we are, like I mentioned, we are on a very good trajectory. We are doing challenges continuously, at least two to three set of challenges every year. Recently, we came out with a set of challenges. Over 200 challenges are today out in the open. More than 1,000 startups are participating. In addition, we have also created something called Suomoto proposal, under which any startup who has some new technology which they think can be used by defense, they don't have to wait for a challenge being thrown in that area. They can offer it Suomoto. They can pitch it in the roadshows which IDEX holds. And in case that solution or technology appeals to the armed forces, it can be taken forward from there also. So, you know, I think there is reasonable momentum, reasonably good momentum on being able to do this, and we should consolidate on these progress that has been made.
Sure, sir. Sir, next question, which is one of the most asked question. Sir, as we all know, you are an electrical engineer from IIT Kanpur. So, sir, how did you identify your interest, your specific interest, and in moving on towards the civil services?
You know, I think this is a personal call which people take from time to time. Civil service provides you tremendous opportunity to be at the service of the nation. I must also say I have been fortunate to have spent a lot of my time in IT and electronics and now in defense. And in both these jobs, I have had adequate opportunity to be able to use my technical, whatever, you know, knowledge or expertise. And therefore, I have found the civil service to be even more fulfilling. But particularly now, with great focus on technology within the government, I think engineers have tremendous advantage and opportunity to contribute. And the importance of technology, the technologies per se may change from, will continuously change, will not remain the same. But the focus of on technology within government and in society at large will remain, I think, at least in the foreseeable future. So to that extent, I think there is a lot of synergy between the engineering studies and in the civil service domain that one gets into. But having said that, I am of the strong view that this is a more of a personal call which individuals take. And each one of you, you know, today youngsters, when we were young, no one thought of going for a startup, you know. Today, a lot of youngsters, bright youngsters, think in terms of startups and creating wealth through startups. And I think that is equally noble way of serving the country. So it's not that I feel that civil service is a greater way of serving the country. You could have multiple ways of doing which you would do. However, I think what is most important is that wherever you go and whatever you do, you should be having the desire, you should have the interest and the desire to do well in that field of your choice. That is the most important thing.
Yes, sir. Sir, next one is, how is geopolitics around India affecting Indian youth in the recent future?
Affecting Indian youth?
Yes, sir.
Let me put it like this. Indian youth is today very, you know, is some a sought after commodity. But for COVID, today, you know, and I have traveled across the world, have had discussions like with various countries on various sectors. The respect which Indian youth enjoys in most parts of the world as being intelligent, law-abiding, disciplined, is phenomenal. And to that extent, I think there is a huge demand and opportunity for Indian. Today, you know, companies throng to come and recruit an engineering, I know much better than other sectors, but in all sectors, they throng to come and recruit from India, even without having to go for, global placement systems. So I think, and this, as India's own stature has increased in the new world order, I won't call it a new world order, an emerging world order, this is only getting enhanced. Our recent tensions on the border, I don't think has in any way diminished any of this. Whatever effect has had been because of COVID and the overall, you know, limitations which have been put on travel and interactions across global systems. But otherwise, I think, in fact, you know, compared to, again, it's, you know, the best way I think is to compare what used to happen when I graduated, and a large number of countries where, you know, Indians were taken with some reluctance today, those countries are opening their doors and, you know, accepting Indians' youth with wide open arms. So I think there is a huge opportunity, and once we see that the global pandemic is receding, there is all the opportunities in the world for youth, Indian youth, to avail of. There is no shyness today to say, I mean, this was a story when 25 years back, the story used to go when, for the first time, people realized if you were an IT company and you wanted to go for an IPO, you started having an Indian's name on your, you know, board of directors, or to show that you were an intellectual company. But before that, it was a reverse. Indians went there and changed their name to look like a more anglicized name. Now, I have seen that when we graduated, situation was my batchmates used to go to US, would change their name so that the name would look a little bit more anglicized. Tamil would become Sam and so forth. I mean, then came the time of IT industry when for the first time we saw people would want a Ramamurthy or a, you know, Banerjee or a Kumar on their, you know, IPO detail list. First time they wanted Indian's name to be there. Now it's that today there is no question at all levels in the organization. People are happy to accept Indians in their companies and organizations world over. So I don't think there is, today the world has, I have in my lifetime seen a 180 degree reversal of this.
Sure, sir. So moving on, taking some questions from the chat box. We have, how do you handle the pressure situations, and what are the lessons that you have learned from your past experience during your IIT days, as well as your IS preparation and as well as officer days?
So I must say that I was never a very serious student in IIT. I used to be found most of the times, you know, playing table tennis or patta cricket for long hours. I was one of those. I was also the general secretary of this, what in Kanpur we used to have the Student Film Society. So I used to be one of those who used to be active on the so-called extracurricular activity front. And I don't know, it's not that I was a great film person or something like that, but I used to enjoy doing these activities. So I wasn't a very serious student. I was not also one of those 9.9 or 10 pointers throughout. Of course, I had my share of 10 points, but not one of those top 10 pointers in IIT. I think in some ways it has helped me in my job, where of course, you know, I mean, the pressures can always be quite, you know, huge. But I the only thing which I try to do is, and I will not say I've been always successful, is that if you have multiple things going on, multiple pressure points, focus at one thing at a time. Just cut yourself off from others and decide the time you can allot for that particular thing. And for that moment, nothing else exists for me. And once I'm done with that, then I go to the second problem. And then you keep doing this. Most often than not, when you start doing this, you realize you have time for all the problems to attend to. In some cases, if you are not able to, you still have the satisfaction you did what you could. I mean, you did your best. And that itself is a great stress buster.
Yes, sir. So, moving on. Sir, your views on involvement of robotics and AI in particular defense as well as other government sectors?
Oh yeah, I mean today, I mean this is, Putin said that, you know, the country which will rule, which will control AI will rule the world. And I mean, I think defense is seeing a huge transformation because of robotics and AI. One of the reasons, and I missed to mention this, and thank you for bringing this up, why we think the opportunity for defense is now more than ever before is because the defense equipment is getting transformed with the use of new emerging technologies, AI, robotics being an important part of it. And in the civil commercial space, I spoke about how our IT industry is, etc. We have significant capability in this regard. And since the role of technology and AI is increasing so much, it is only question of us translating these into the defense sector. Second is, these new technologies, you know, are, you know, the world is flat. And so the opportunities for young, you know, people, startups, and to actually come up is much more as compared to, suppose, if you were to look at setting up a semiconductor fabrication plant, which is a multi-billion dollar investment to begin with. And even to create a chip is a sometimes a $100 million or $1 billion, you know, even to create a prototype of a chip could be such a costly affair. But here in digitization-led you know, platforms, today you can create new functionalities, new features, new capabilities, unmanning, network systems, all of which can be done at a software level, at a which is much more, much less capital intensive. So the opportunities for us are more. The capability exists in the outside world, in the startups, in the industry, and it's just bringing these capabilities with defense can help us do the trick.
Yes, sir. So moving on, one last question, and it is one of the most asked question. Sir, we all know your involvement with Rafael. You went on for the delivery of those. So sir, what do you rate the technical aspect of that particular the particular machine developed, and the machines which are developed particularly in India, the made in India machines, and how are they standing in front of that?
Yeah, so you know, so Rafale is one of the best planes today in the world in terms of fighter jets, in number of functionalities, but and it is definitely, you know, the significantly, it's a different class of ship. It is like saying, how would you rate Maruti vis-a-vis, you know, let's say a bigger car like BMW or something. Maybe BMW also a smaller car, but what I mean to say, they are different category. Rafale is a bigger jet. What we have produced in India, the Tejas, LCA Tejas, is also extremely advanced aircraft, but it's a much lighter aircraft. And therefore, its usage is different. The distance it can travel is different. Its capability is different. So it is meant for different. And in a war situation, you plan for different kind of aircrafts to do different things. What LCA has, and LCA is the first fighter jet that we have developed in this country today. It is really in its own category, one of the best in the world. But Rafale is a different category altogether. But what has happened is, it has given us the confidence that we can actually develop more advanced aircrafts in the country, and which is something which we are actually in process of doing. So you will see more advanced aircrafts also coming out from India as well.
Yes, sir. So that's it for the Q&A session. Sir, your final message to students, if you want to give it.
No, I think all I can say is that, you know, it's a different world where you go out today as compared to what it was 35 years back when I, you know, 37 years back when I graduated. The world is, you know, there are no limitations for you. There are no constraints for you. And you
you can do, you have opportunity to do and achieve what your imagination is capable of. So my best wishes for a very bright and a new India, a new world, which you will all create for yourself. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, sir. Thanks a lot for taking out your precious time for interacting with us. So thanks a
all
lot.
All the best.
Thanks a lot.
All the best. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So we'll be ending our session here. Keep updated for the next guest lecture series. Thank you.